the Czech Republic is taking over the presidency of the EU Council from France. It has to face the fact that Russia's unprovoked invasion in Ukraine represents the greatest geopolitical and systemic challenge the EU has ever faced. This means the Czech presidency has to contribute to guiding the EU through the troubled waters of its Zeitenwende that is on the horizon in so many vital policy areas, while at the same time not losing sight of the EU's unity, institutional reform needs and the results of the conference on the future of Europe. First, it has to sustain the proactive role that the EU has exercised at regional and global level in reaction to the war. This includes using fully the European Peace Facility, of which 2 billion euros have been activated for military assistance to Ukrainian armed forces. Second, the EU needs to address the EU's current limits as a geopolitical actor that the war in Ukraine has confirmed. The strategic compass adopted in March emerged already obsolete, since the attack on February 24th led member states to revise only its narrative, not its substance. It thus cannot provide the framework to realize what is most needed in the current context. In EU capacity, project a credible military force outside its borders and to enhance deterrence with a view to offering adequate security guarantees to its citizens and neighbors while exercising more collective weight within NATO. Concrete initiatives should be identified to make use in a joint or at least coordinated fashion of the additional budgetary resources member states are currently allocating. At the same time, decision-making rules which would allow the deployment of European forces quickly and effectively, such as the recourse to Article 44 of the TEU for military operations or the introduction of qualified majority voting for civilian missions, should be considered further. Another weak spot of the EU that the war in Ukraine painfully disclosed is the dependence on Russian fossil fuels of some EU countries. The EU and its member states need to refocus the energy mixes on alternative energy sources on the one hand and establish common purchase and storage mechanisms on the other. Those actions must be in full compliance and commitment with the aims of the Green Deal. The Czech presidency will have to mediate the asymmetric challenge for EU member states due to differences in national energy mixes, because full commitment to energy sanctions is of crucial importance. Third, the Czech presidency will have to preserve unity and solidarity within the EU. Building on the principle of united in diversity, recurring to the creation of coalitions of the willing that reflect the changing alignments between member states when it comes to areas of reform can be helpful. One area where a differentiated approach, however, cannot be accepted and where the EU is fundamentally challenged is the rule of law. The EU needs to make sure to use and implement the full range of rule of law mechanisms at its disposal in order to realign Hungary with European values. Nevertheless, while Hungary may well be the EU's biggest headache, it is far from being the only one. Continued and enhanced efforts for preserving the future integrity of rule of law in the European continent are required. Fourth, it will be during the Czech presidency when the EU needs to frame the accession perspective of Ukraine as well as Georgia and the Republic of Moldova. This also requires the EU to rethink its enlargement policy. Additionally, the EU will need a longer-term Russia policy, a redesigning of the Eastern Partnership together with a strengthening of its southern neighborhood to face common challenges to come. If we add up the changes of perception when it comes to security, we are entering to a new era where both the borders and relations with countries outside of the EU will need in-depth rethinking. Finally, the Czech presidency is tasked to monitor the implementation of the process of the Conference on the Future of Europe. The European Parliament proposed the establishment of a convention for treaty reform, the French President Emmanuel Macron openly supported this plan, and the President of the European Commission, Ursula von der Leyen, did not exclude the need for a change in the treaties. Yet 13 member states have just clearly stated their opposition in a non-paper. As it will be ultimately in the hands of the member states to take the final decision, this crucial task for the EU will be to moderate the settlement of this key question. It surely is time to think about how to create an EU that fits better in the 21st century. It is our task to come up with proposals for guaranteeing the EU comes out of this current period much stronger, without wasting the momentum of change that is implicit in the current fundamental challenges to Europe's peace and unity.
Russia's invasion of Ukraine has really launched a new era for the development of the EU as a security actor. I believe an urgent question now is, how does EU defence contribute to the defence of its member states and partners vis-à-vis the Russian threat and the aggressive efforts by Russia to re-establish a sphere of influence. More concretely, what this means for EU defense is, first of all, that now is the time to further strengthen the relationship between the EU and NATO, stressing the complementary roles of the two organizations. In the field of capability planning and development of capabilities, there is scope for much more synergy between the EU and NATO. Another area where the EU has an important complementary role to play is cyber defense, which has developed very rapidly in the past couple of years, and there is much scope for the EU to play an even stronger role. And thirdly, the EU has all of a sudden become an important actor in supporting its partners, notably Ukraine, to defend itself. And here again, there is an important role for the EU to play and scope to further strengthen its contribution to European security and defence.
Faced with Russia's invasion of Ukraine, the EU seeks greater energy autonomy. This policy shift is in line with the EU's energy transition and security of supply, but it will be costly and challenging. The Czech presidency should focus on boosting the diversification of energy sources and setting a clear timetable for phasing out Russian fossil fuels, especially gas. The interconnectedness of critical energy infrastructure in Europe needs to be improved. It is also crucial to ensure sufficient gas storage reserves. The targets for renewables and energy efficiency outlined in the Fit for 55 proposal should be accelerated. There is a need for greater citizens' involvement and change attitudes to energy consumption across Europe. Appropriate national schemes for price regulation to counter energy price volatility will be also necessary. Lastly, cooperation within the energy community will be key to meeting common energy policy goals. The EU member states should also further develop energy trade links with the external suppliers to secure the best deals.
To the question, how does the current humanitarian crisis affect the reform of a common EU asylum policy? We need first of all to establish the context. Thus, the upcoming Czech presidency may have a window of opportunity in reforming the migration and asylum policy following the fact that during the pandemic, we have witnessed a slowdown of the irregular migration and also given the current favorable public opinion regarding the Ukrainian refugees. Thus, given the security aspects and the different divisions between East and West, the accent should be put on combating irregular migration by preventing the root causes of migration in third countries, with a possible focus on the migration of people labeled as risk factors and also on fighting illegal stay inside the EU and the human trafficking networks. Secondly, another aspect of importance should be the implementation of the new architectures of European intelligence system as regards the border protection and an increase of interconnectivity between all the member states. Thirdly, the question of Schengen area should be reopened with regards to Romania and Bulgaria. We can no longer have such a strategic dissonance in a time when unity is required. If the technical conditions are fulfilled, then the political will must intervene and allow those who are able and willing to join the Schengen area. Fourthly, a stronger partnership with the African states is needed, alongside the implementation of programs designed to reduce the migratory intensity and better fight the irregular migration, while also concluding efficient migration management agreements with all these states. Fifth, another point of interest to be considered by the presidency refers to the social consequences of the current migratory situation. People from Ukraine need to be integrated into society, schools, language, and so on, knowing also that most of the Ukrainians are determined to return home. At the end of the day, the main solution in this author opinion is to help the states of origin to develop better economies and societies that provide a local-based future and opportunities for all the potential migrants.
EU support to Ukraine's defense and reconstruction must be timely, and its size must correspond to an ambition for a common, secure and prosperous Europe. Ukraine's reconstruction should be framed as a project for building a modern, democratic state within the framework of the EU accession process. If the June European Council agrees that Ukraine should be granted a candidate status for EU membership, the Czech presidency of the Council will have the task of organizing the first steps in the accession process. Otherwise, the Czech presidency should work on finding consensus on Ukraine's candidate status by October. Second, the EU's support to Ukraine should be more systematic and proactive, including in terms of defense equipment. The Czech presidency should work closely with the High Representative to coordinate it. Close cooperation with NATO is necessary too. Ukrainian forces should be trained on newer and more sophisticated Western weapons. The Czech presidency should initiate a discussion on creating a 3-month reserve of ammunition and other military supplies. Thirdly, Ukraine's reconstruction will require the EU to step up its financial support to the country. The Czech presidency should start building consensus on necessary increases in heading 6 of the EU budget, neighborhood and the world, and on the creation of a sufficiently powerful new financial instrument for rebuilding Ukraine. We think that the EU will need to increase its capacity to borrow, as with Next Generation EU, in order to be able to meaningfully support Ukraine's reconstruction. Of course, investments in Ukraine's reconstruction should be aligned with the objectives of the European Green Deal. Early rebuilding is important to enable gradual return of refugees and internally displaced persons.